Hi, this is Jeff from Wunderdog Sports. Welcome to part 8 of my How to Win at Sports Betting video series. In this video, I'm going to tell you what line movement is and why it happens frequently. I'll explain the difference between two types of sports bettors, sharps and squares, and how they affect lines. I'll talk about key numbers in sports betting and why they are very important. I'll also cover key sports betting terms like middling, steam moves, and reverse line movement. Finally, I'll give you guidance on what you can do when a line moves on you. Okay, so let's jump right into it. What is line movement? It's simply when a line or spread moves in one direction or the other, which happens often in sports betting. It is a rare line that stays exactly where it was when opened by the sports books. Here's an example of a line movement from Super Bowl 44. As you can see, the Colts opened as a 3.5-point favorite in this game, but moved pretty quickly to a 5.5-point favorite. The over-under moved up 2 points from 54.5 to 56.5. Why did the line move 2 points in each case? Because from the sportsbook's perspective, too much money was coming in on one side, and leaving the lines where they were would have given them massive exposure that they don't want. In this example, the vast majority of money was coming in on the Colts at -3.5. So in order to encourage more bets on the Saints to even the action out, the odds makers moved the line to -4. When that didn't have the desired effect, they moved it to -4.5, and then -5, and then -5.5. The same thing happened on the total, as too much money was coming in on the over. What does this mean? It means that if you like the Colts or the over, you would have rather bet them early, as you'd be laying 3.5 points instead of 5.5, and getting a total of 54.5 instead of 56.5. So, what causes line movements? Generally, there are two reasons. First off, there may be a key player that gets injured, or a coach announces they're gonna be sitting players. Secondly, betting activity moves lines. For the rest of this video, I'm gonna focus on this second reason. Oddsmakers initially set a line based on where they think it should be based on their goals. Notice that I did not say that they set lines based on what they think is fair or what the right line is. They set it based on their goals, which can differ game to game. It's true that usually their goal is to split the betting activity, getting about 50% of the bets on one side and 50% on the other. This way, they can't lose. They simply pay out the winners, minus their 10% juice or big, and collect from the losers. The commission on the winning bets ensures them a tidy profit. But the oddsmaker's goal sometimes is to actually take lopsided action. They sometimes roll the dice, believing that the betting public will be on the wrong side and they can score a huge win. Contrary to popular belief, bets are rarely split 50-50 on most games. There is quite often lopsided betting. To see this in action, check out the consensus betting tool on my website. As you can see, there are often games in which 60% or 70% or even 80% of the action is on one side. So on any given game, the sportsbooks can have high exposure. But spread out over hundreds of games per week, their exposure is relatively limited. The biggest exposure for them, of course, is on the big games, in which the betting is so heavy that it dwarfs the betting activity of other events. The most obvious example of this is the Super Bowl. Sportsbooks have massive exposure on both sides of negative and positive on this game, given the high number of bets. In the Super Bowl 44 example mentioned earlier, 65% of the bets were on Indianapolis, meaning that the sportsbooks were rooting for the Saints in the end, and they did cover. Another question I often get is who exactly moves the lines, squares or sharps? Let me first define these terms. A sharp, also known as a wise guy, is an experienced, skilled bettor, one that can and does win money at sports betting. A square is everybody else, basically the general betting public, unskilled and losing long term. The answer to which group drives line movement is it depends. On low profile games, line movements, also known as steams, tend to be more driven by sharps. The percentage of money that sharps place on low profile games is relatively high, so their bets have a bigger movement impact. One indication of a sharp move would be on a game in which the percentage of bets is very high on team A, say 65%, but the line is moving in the opposite direction, indicating heavier dollar volume betting on team B. Despite only 35% of actual bets coming in on that team, the amount of money bet on that team is higher. In this case, you can bet the line movement is due to very large bets placed by a few sharps. The betting public is betting small amounts on team A, while the sharps are betting massive amounts on team B. This is called reverse line movement. Some people employ a betting strategy that looks for this kind of action, and they go with the side the sharps are on, assuming they know what they're doing. But if you get in on the game after the sharps have already fully moved the line, the value's already gone. In higher profile games, specifically the Super Bowl, the roles reverse. On the Super Bowl, the public money from Joe Square dwarfs that of the Sharps. So, line movements on that kind of game tend to be more driven by general betting public. Knowing the source of your steam is important, so you can know if it's coming from in-the-know bettors or the losing public. Okay, let's move on and talk about key numbers and middling. In many sports, but football in particular, there are key numbers as it relates to the spread. Due to the scoring structure of football, an inordinate number of football games end with a team winning by 3, 7, 9, and 10 points. The most common margin of victory, of course, in football games is 3 points, which happens about 15% of the time, followed by 7 points, occurring around 8% of the time. Contrast that with only 3% of the games ending in a 5-point margin of victory. This is important as it relates to line movement. Why? Because odds makers try not to move a line too much, and they try extremely hard to avoid moving a line over a key number. Doing so exposes them to a massive losses from bettors middling them. A middling opportunity arises when a line moves by a large amount, especially if it moves over a key number. This opportunity gives the bettor a chance to win 2 bets with little risk. The sports books, of course, do not like this. Here's an example. Team A is favored by 2.5 points over Team B. Bettors think Team A at -2.5 is a bargain, so they place a lot of money on that team. Seeing the wildly uneven action, the odds makers realize they set the line wrong. And to encourage more bets on Team B, they move the line from 2.5 to 3. But the bets keep coming in on Team A even at -3. There's not enough action on Team B. If this continues and Team A covers the spread, the sportsbooks stand to lose big. So, reluctant as they are to cross the key number of 3, they move the line again to Team A -3.5. Now, this does the trick, as now a bunch of money comes in on Team B at +3.5. Some of these new bets may actually be placed by the same people who bet Team A at -2.5. Why would someone bet both sides of the game? Because if the final score has Team A winning by exactly 3 points, they win both bets. And remember, 3 is the most common margin of victory in football. Anyway, in the end, the sportsbook has about an even amount of money on Team A and Team B in this scenario, so they're safe, right? No, wrong. Most of the bets on Team A came in at -2.5, and most of the bets on Team B are at +3.5. As luck would have it, Team A wins the game by exactly 3 points. So what happens to the sportsbook here? They lose all the many bets placed on Team A at -2.5, and they lose all the many bets players made on Team B at +3.5. It's an absolute nightmare for them, and they lose their shirt. In this scenario, they got middled. As you can imagine, the sportsbooks look to avoid this at all costs, and as such, rarely let lines cross key numbers. And they try to get the initial line right so they don't have to move it much. They will also employ another trick to avoid getting middled. Instead of moving a line over a key number, they will often leave the line unchanged, but change the odds required to bet that line, affecting the juice. For example, you'll often see Team A, say, opens up as an 8.5-point favorite at -110 odds. They get a lot of bets on Team A, but rather than move the line to a 9 or 9.5-point favorite and risk being middled, they'll keep them as an 8.5-point favorite, but move the odds to, say, -125. So you can still bet Team A at -8.5, but instead of risking 110 to win 100, you have to risk 125 to win 100. This has the desired effect of evening out the bets without requiring a line movement that would risk a middle for them. Be aware of key numbers, guys, and look for these rare middling opportunities. Okay, the final topic I want to discuss with you is what you should do when a line moves on you. When I send out picks, I shop for the best lines and use those. If you missed my video on the importance of line shopping, it is a must watch, so go back and review it after this. Now, when you go to place your bet, your line or odds will not always exactly match what I send out. When you go to place a bet, sometimes you won't be able to find that same line, and this can happen for 2 reasons. First, the sportsbook you use may have a slightly different line. Sportsbooks don't always exactly agree. It's not uncommon to find a half point or even a point difference, simply due to the fact that each sportsbook is different and each is there to balance their own risk. The best way to combat this is to open up multiple accounts and line shop. As mentioned in that line shopping video, if you can find an extra half a point here and there, you're gonna win a lot more. Secondly, some time may have elapsed between when the pick was sent out or handicapped and when you can place your bet. In that time, the line has moved due to betting activity. In either case, I'm often asked what to do, place the bet anyway or pass. Let's look at what could happen with your bet, assuming you bet it using the new, different line. There are actually 8 different scenarios based on whether the line moves for you, meaning in your favor, or against you. The first 4 outcomes are neutral or good. First of all, the line can move for you and has no effect on the bet outcome. This is a neutral outcome, meaning there's no difference compared to what would have happened if the line didn't move in the first place. Secondly, the line moves for you and turns a loss into a push. Obviously, this is a good outcome. Thirdly, the line can move for you and turn a push, which would have been a tie, into a winner. Good outcome. Finally, 4, the line moves for you and turns a loss into a winner. Really good outcome. Now, the next 4 outcomes are either neutral or bad. 5th, the line moves against you and has no effect on the bet outcome. Neutral. 6th, the line moves against you and turns a winner into a push. Bad outcome. The line moves against you and turns a push into a loss. Bad outcome. And finally, the line moves against you and turns a winner into a loser. Really bad. Guys, over the long haul, about half the time, the line moves will be in your favor, and the other half, they'll work against you. Clearly, if a line moves in your favor, there's no big decision to make. Place the bet at the better line. But what if the line moves against you? What if the team you wanted at +4.5 is now +4, or +3.5, or even +3? In that scenario, you are susceptible to the 2nd of the 4 scenarios I covered. What should you do then? Unfortunately, there's no one right answer. In order to have one right answer, we'd need to know which of the 4 bad scenarios was most likely. But we don't know the outcome of the game yet, so we can't predict whether the line move against you will have a neutral or negative effect. All we know for sure is that it won't improve your possible outcomes. If we could predict with that level of accuracy down to like a half a point on a regular basis, we'd all be millionaires, right? Of course, if you're doing your own sophisticated handicapping, you'll often know that you don't like a team anymore after a line move. If you're using someone else's picks like mine, you still have a decision to make. If you lay off the game or take down your bet size on it, 2 things can happen. If the bet wins anyway, you may be upset for leaving your money on the table. If you reduce your bet or pass on it and the bet loses, however, then you're happy you saved yourself some money. Big pat on the back. But since we can't know beforehand which of these 2 things is going to happen, then what do? Well, we apply some logic and we take into account your personal risk preferences. Logic dictates that the more a line moves, the higher the chance it will affect the outcome. If a line moves a half a point, especially not off a key number, that's a small move and is unlikely to affect the outcome of the bet. If it moves 2 or 2.5 or more points, it's much more likely to affect the outcome. Risk preference simply refers to how you personally feel about taking risks. If you're a natural risk taker, then you may decide to ignore the line move and roll the dice. Sure, you have a worse line, but if your team wins big, it doesn't matter. So in this case, you could just play it at your normal level and hope for the best. If, on the other hand, you can't stand the thought of a line movement turning your winner into a loser, and you tend to be more risk averse, then you might choose to lay off the game, or at least take your bet size down. You may reason, hey, if it wins, I'll win less, but that's okay. It's better than the thought of losing due to a pesky line change. Another option at your disposal is to make the pick at the desired original line, but pay a higher commission for the privilege. Sometimes the sportsbooks force this choice on you by increasing the juice on the pick, as mentioned earlier. Other times, you have the choice of doing this yourself with the sportsbook. This is called buying points. Buying points simply means you pay a higher price, more commission, in exchange for a better line. Should you employ this strategy? Well, unless you're a sophisticated bettor, the general answer is no. Why? Because the cost of this over time will eat up your profits in a way that isn't intuitive. I've studied buying points across all sports, and based on the math, the only time I recommend consider buying is when buying a half point on or off of 3 in football. This means you could be consider buying +2.5 up to +3, buying -3.5 down to -3. Doing this has been proven to be slightly profitable over the long haul versus not buying. Any other buying of points, in my opinion, is generally a mistake. Buying on or off of 3 in football makes some sense, but the edge is pretty small and it only occurs over the long term. The best benefit might be the emotional one you get from being able to turn a loss into a push or push into a win. In the end, it's up to you and how you personally feel about the possible outcomes. In the 4 negative scenarios I shared earlier, if they really scare you and you'll be very upset about losing due to a line movement, then back down on your play or lay off it. If you aren't really that scared by these scenarios and could take a possible loss in stride, kind of tell yourself that sometimes you win, sometimes you lose, and next time maybe the line movement will help you, then you can just let it ride. If you're committed to becoming an elite sports handicapper for yourself, then you must track your decisions on this and measure their success over time. Okay, so I hope you feel like you now understand the reasons behind line movements and your options when it happens to you. Stay tuned for my third bonus video coming up next, in which I'm gonna tell you how to spot and avoid scammers in the world of sports betting.